Hello and welcome to another class of Multivariate Statistical Analysis course. Today we will talk about sample geometry and random sampling. To illustrate everything, we will use a couple of problems. First, remember that we used to represent p variables on n observations in a matrix X. So say that we now have two variables and three observations. For each variable, we can use column as a vector, or for each observation, we can use row as a vector. So in this case, because we have only two variables, we have two columns, so we have two vectors, y1 and y2. Those two vectors are in three-dimensional space because they have three coordinates. First vector, for example, has coordinates 9, 5, and 1. In other case, if we look for each observation that we have another vector, then we have three vectors, so x1 transpose x2 and x3, and each of the vectors has two coordinates. So in that case, we have two different spaces. One two-dimensional space and the other one is three-dimensional space. Let's first illustrate geometrically the two-dimensional space that is less interesting. So because we have two-dimensional space, that means that we have n vectors, so three vectors. Let's represent them in a scatter plot and let's represent the means, the sample mean of this two-dimensional space. What I mean by the sample mean? Actually, the vector that we introduced earlier. So this vector will contain mean of those three, so the first coordinates, and the mean, the second one, the second coordinate will be the mean, the sample mean of those three coordinates. So to illustrate that, we just find the means, so x1 and x2, this is our notation, and our vector x in two-dimensional space would be 5, 2. So as you would guess, to represent it in a scatter plot in two-dimensional space, we will just find them on the 1, 2 axis. So the notation is not important. You can name it x and y if you wish, and just find corresponding values. So for example, for the first vector we have 9, 1. So we find 9, 1, and this is our vector x1. And our x, we can represent it on the scatter plot as well. It is 5, 2, so 5, 2. However, when we are in three-dimensional space, so when we have only two vectors, things get a little bit more interesting. And instead of looking of those two vectors as points, we will actually look at them as vectors in a sense that you would guess, like Euclidean sense, even though this one is also a vector. But let's look at those vectors, those two, in a different way now. So assume that we have three-dimensional space. So our first vector has coordinates y1, had coordinates 9, 5, 1. So to illustrate that vector, we will need to find, because it's now three-dimensional, we need to use three axes. So we need to find 9, 5, and 1, so depending how do you name the axes, so because this is our second, we need to find 5 here, and 1. So instead of just putting a point here, we will look at this as a Euclidean vector, let's say. So from the origin to that point here, in the direction to the point. So this is our vector y1. We can also find y2, but let's do it in GeoGebra instead. This is a program that you can use to play with. So this is GeoGebra, and I already plotted those two vectors. So as you can see, from the origin to A, this is our first y1, so this is our first vector, and the second one, y2, is from the origin to the point B. So point B is 1, 3, 2. This is how we chose it. This obviously looks a little bit better than handwriting. You can always play with it. So this is the sketch of three-dimensional space. Let's now introduce deviation vectors. So the deviation vectors are actually the observed values minus the mean. So in a sense, it is a deviation from the mean. As you can see, we can represent this vector as a vector, so where we take observation minus its mean. But how can we actually represent this vector on our sketch? Well, to do that, we would first need to plot vector 1, 1, 1. So this is our unit vector. But that unit vector is not normalized, so its length is not 1. This is just vector 1, 1, 1. So when we plot it, it looks like this. Let's go to GeoGebra and plot vector 1, 1, 1. Because we will illustrate everything on our first vector, we can see that this vector, so it goes from origin to C. This is our unit vector 1, 1, 1, so all coordinates are 1. Okay, this is how it looks like. And what we actually want to do is to extend this, so to imagine a line through this vector in that direction and find a perpendicular, or say a projection of this vector on our unit vector. So we can look now here. So we have a triangle. So imagine that this is origin, and this is the line that I mentioned that goes through origin in the direction of our unit vector. But instead of unit vector, we can look, for example, at normalized unit vector. So what I mean by normalized is that its length is actually 1. So how can we get length of 1? Well, first, we know that, for example, 1 transposed 1 is our length squared. Or it's maybe easier to look at the length as 1 squared plus 1 squared plus 1 squared, so it's 3, and square root of that. So our length is square root of 3 in this case. In general, it is square root of n. So let's now generalize this. We don't want to look just our case when we have three-dimensional space, but instead we will look in n-dimensional space. So we can normalize it in a way that we just multiply this vector with 1 divided by square root of n, because its length is square root of n. That way, this is our normalized unit vector. And what do we actually want is to project now our n-dimensional vector, y1, on this unit vector. So, by projection, what do we usually mean? Well, the projection is given by this formula. So here we actually project where this is our scalar product. So we actually project our u vector on vector v. So u vector on v vector. In our case, we want to project y1 on a normalized vector. So what we actually need to do, so u is y1, so y1 transposed, because we here have scalar product. So what does it actually mean? That the first one is transposed, the other one is not. This is how you can get this formula. And our v is our unit vector. So when we substitute u times v, so it's y1 transpose times 1 divided by square root of n times 1, then norm of our v squared, because we normalized it, we know that it is actually 1, so 1 squared is 1, times our vector. So this vector is our projection. When we multiply this and arrange it, we will actually get the sum of our vectors in a column. Okay, so we will actually get our sample mean of, for example, because we have y1, we will get just x1 bar, so the mean of our vector. How do we get it? We just multiply it. So this is our vector transpose times 1, 1, 1, 1, and then we have 1 divided by square root of n and 1 divided by square root of n. This will make it 1 divided by n. And this is actually sum, so when we multiply it, it is actually sum of vectors of elements of y1. And sum of those elements, so we can go back, sum of those elements is 9 plus 5 plus 1. So it is our mean, because we have divided by n here. You can write this down if it's not clear. So what did we actually get? We get the projection. So actually, by projection, we mean that the angle, when we take this vector or this line, so this angle here is 90 degrees, so it's perpendicular to this one. So this is how we got our projection vector. And how will, in the end, we get our deviation vector? Our deviation vector is actually going to be vector from this point to this point. And how can we get it? So we know that this vector plus this vector is actually y1. So x1, 1 plus, let's say, d1 is equal to y1. So it is equal that our d1, let's say, is equal to y1 minus x1 bar 1. So this is our geometrical interpretation of this deviation vector. Why is it called deviation? Because we correct it with mean. When we see this geometrical point of view, we see that we actually get the mean. So it is actually all our observations minus its mean. So say mean corrected. This is why it's deviation from the mean. What would be the length of this length of deviation vectors? Well, actually we know that the length squared, so when we have length squared, is actually d1 transpose times d1. So this is the length squared, so don't forget it, it's square length of the deviation vector. And we actually get sum of our squared deviations. Okay, so our length of deviation vector squared is our sum of squared deviations. So we can see that it is actually proportional to the variance. As you can remember, the sample variance had the same sum. Also, it is proportional to the standard deviation, but not the square length, instead just length, so square root. As you know, the standard deviation is square root of variance. So we can see the relation between the sample variance and the sample standard deviation and those two vectors that we got using geometry. What would be D1 transpose D2? Well, by multiplying corresponding vectors, you can actually see that there is a sum that you can see in the sample correlation coefficient or in the sample covariance. So there is more correlation, but before we find the relation between the sample covariance and the sample correlation coefficient, let's plot those two vectors. So perhaps it's better to use GeoGebra. So we had, let's remove everything. So our D1 is 4, 0, -4. The other one, let's say x does not matter, x is -1. Let me just check if it's the vector. -1, 1, 0. So -1, 1, 0. So those are our two points for the deviation vectors. Let's write them just so you can see. But those two are from the origin. So it's not like on the picture that I have. So this is how you can see them. Let's go back to the file. So what we actually have is two vectors, and we have some angle between those two vectors. This actually, when both are emitting from the origin, D1 and D2, the angle that they form can be actually used to derive the sample correlation coefficient or sample covariance, in a sense that when we use a little bit of geometry knowledge, we know that actually the length of both vectors can be computed. So we have the coordinates of 4 squared plus 0 plus minus 4 squared. So we have length of D1 and D2. And what is actually the relation? Well, we know that D1 transpose D1 from the above is actually our sum. So when we multiply sum by n, or n minus 1 here, either one of those, we can actually compute our S11. So if we know the length and we know how many observations we have, we can compute the sample variances. This is using only geometry. Similarly, we can compute the sample correlation coefficient using the angle between those. So let's see how does it actually look like. So, okay, so this is our angle. between those two vectors. So in this case, our angle between d1 from the origin and d2 is actually 120 degrees. So here I just used angle and find from, so you just click dAx in our case. So you can see how does the angle look like. Let's go to it. So this is our angle, and it is actually our cosinus of that angle is actually this expression, and in our case when we compute it, it's -0.5. What is 0.5? It is our sample correlation coefficient. So this formula may be used, so this is not squared. This formula can be used to find the sample correlation coefficient as a cosinus of the angle between the two deviations, which is also expected because of this expression. So what we actually get, you can see actually that this d1 transpose d2 is length of the first one, length of the second one, times the cosinus of the angle between those two. So length of one, length of two. Okay, this is our times cosinus of the angle is our d1, d2. Okay. So now we know how to find everything, starting with the sample correlation coefficient because it is going to be symmetrical. Okay. Then we have our S11 and S22, so our sample variances. We can compute them from the length. We already did that. So we know that they are given by 5.66 and square root of 2. Okay, sorry, actually, from here we can see that d1 transpose d1 is actually our sum. So when we multiply it by n or n minus 1, we will get our sample variance. So we don't need to take square root as here. So this is a mistake. So instead, without square, d1 transpose d1 is equal to n times s11. So this is a mistake. But the computation here should be correct anyway. So just remember, this equality holds, but this one doesn't. So instead, we need to remove square root of to get the right value. And S12, because we have S11, S22, SS12 or S21, because they are the same, we just need to compute this value, d1 transpose d2, and multiply it by n or n minus 1. In our case, we will do it with n for now, so with 3. So this value is 3 times the value of d1 transpose d2. So it is -1.33. But you can see the relation between the values, and this is a little bit of algebra, how to get the sample correlation coefficient that I explained earlier. This is just a little bit of moving around and separating the values. So this is what I meant. So LD1 is equal to square root of S11 n. Not like this. So be careful when you're reading this or watching the video again. So in the end, what I mentioned earlier, we get the cosinus between cosinus of angle between d1 and d2 is actually our sample correlation coefficient. This is how we can relate all the quantities in those two matrices to the geometry of the sample. So just a fast reminder, we can look two-dimensional space or three-dimensional space depending on which vectors we take. When we take vectors corresponding to variables, we have n dimensions, so how many coordinates do we have, and the opposite. When we look as n vectors, then we have n vectors in p-dimensional space. Okay, so y1 and y2 we represented as vectors. Similarly, as we did for d1, we can do for d2, even though it's not shown here, but you can try to do the projection and you will get this vector. And in the end, when you find the angle between those two, you can have and compute everything. So just using those two deviation vectors, which we got by projecting y1 on our unit vector. Even if you don't normalize it, you will still get the same result. So it doesn't actually matter. Okay. Let's go to the second problem. Say that we have some data in millions. Okay, so unit of millions. And we want to find the projection, but not on our normalized unit vector, instead on vector 1, which actually now has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So because this is 6 times 2, it has 6 coordinates. So 1, 1, 1 times 6 times. And we want to find the projection of y1, so our y1, on this unit vector, without normalizing him, to see what happens. Of course, because this is now 6 dimensions, it's not possible to do any geometry on it, but you can generalize what we already have. So what is actually our norm? So by the definition, it's 1 squared plus 1 squared, so it's 6. This is our norm of our 1. Why do we need norm? Remember, how does the projection of vector y1 on any other vector looks like? So we want to project y1 on v, in our case 1. So we need actually norm squared. So it's 6. The scalar product is y1 transposed 1. So when we have this one, all three of those, it is equivalent to this. So just by substituting and multiplying, let's fix this one. So we have square root of 6, square root of 6, so it is 6. Okay, and when we multiply y1 with 1, so this is a column with all ones, and this is a vector of these values. So what we actually get by multiplication, so this times 1 plus this times 1 plus this times 1, so we actually get sum of all those values, all those 6 values. It is actually our mean of the first variable, x1 times this vector, we can leave it 1. This is basically what we did in previous, so we did the same. We just did not show the summation. Okay, so our deviation vector, the first one, when computing, so this vector minus x1, 1. So how does x1, 1 look like? Well, it is a vector. This is a number times 1, 1, 1, 1, so it is a vector. Don't forget that this is a number. And then we get our deviation vector for the first one. Let's see what is the relation between the length, so the length of this deviation vector, and the sample standard deviation. So even though we showed it in lower dimensions geometrically, it holds as well when we have dimension of, so space with dimension of 6. So it is actually square root of our sum of square deviation mean divided by n, or in this case 6. So this is how you can relate the sample standard deviation and the length. When you do your calculations, it is actually the same as in problem 1, but instead we have square root of 6 because we have square root here. Okay, so this is our relationship between those two. Let's see how would the graph look like when we scale it down. So we should always keep in mind that this is a vector, but this is a vector with 6 coordinates. As well as this one, this is actually our one vector in 6-dimensional space. So length of this one is square root of 6, the same way as before. When computing the length of any other vector, we should be always careful in what dimension are we in. So x1, 1 is actually our column, where we have x1 6 times. Okay, and our x1, when we compute it, it's 2.01 something. So it is 6 times, because we have 6 times this, 6 times the mean. And then we just, because it's plus, 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 then we just square root, take square root of it. So we need squared here. Sorry for that. Okay, and the length of the deviation vector can be also computed easily. So you find we have deviation vector, so we just find this number. The length has been just shown. So remember that this is in millions, that is why we have so many decimals. And in the end, let's see how can we relate as before this angle between those two. So in our case d1 and d2, because we have only two deviation vectors corresponding to y1 and y2. And angle sum theta 1, theta 2. And using the relation that we showed that works for 3 dimension, it also works for 6. So this is our expression. From that expression, we can actually find the angle between the two deviation vectors using inverse of cosinus. So when we use inverse, we can find angle of theta, angle between d1 and d2. So just simple inverse function, arcus cosinus. So here we are only computed first deviation vector. However, the second one can be computed the same way, just to save time. And when you compute the second one, we can always compute this number and also this number. Those two are easy. And then just find using some calculator or similar inverse of this number, and that way you can find the angle. So this is the angle between the two deviation vectors. Okay, let's introduce the generalized variance. So let's introduce actually one numerical value, so just one number that will express the variation that is contained in our covariance matrix S. that number will be the determinant of our sample covariance matrix. Of course, some of the information that is contained in the determinant of S is going to be lost, so we will try to interpret this number as better as we can. Consider first two deviation vectors, so D1 and D2, and that we have P is equal to 2. Okay, so in that case, those two deviation vectors actually form some kind of trapezoid, so this one. It can be shown that the area of this trapezoid can be represented using only our sample variances or the sample covariances, sample coefficient, correlation coefficient. So only those two values from what we previously actually derived, because we found the already relation between D1, D2 and our covariances and variances. So it is actually easy to prove that the determinant, our determinant of the sample covariance matrix, is equal to the area, so in this case this area, divided by n minus 1 squared. So because we are in two dimensions, we have just trapezoid. In three dimensions, we would have a cube or similar, so we would have volume. So we have time Lebesgue measurement depending in which dimension are we. So for three dimensions it's volume, for two dimensions it's area, like here. So this one can be computed. We can call it measure or just area of whatever they form in that dimension. So the algebra between the relationship and between this area will not be represented, but it can be shown, just so you can know that. And the general, it can be seen that the general sample variance is always equal to the Lebesgue measurement of this set that the deviation vectors create. So imagine like three vectors, one here, then we would have some somewhat like cube or similar, divided by n minus 1 to the power of p. So our p is the dimension. How many deviation vectors do we actually have? Let's say it like this. Okay. This is our geometrical interpretation of general sample variance. Before continuing, let's say what actually this equation represents. So here it should be x bar. So this is actually, let's say, mean-centered ellipse or hyper-ellipsoid, depending on in which space we are. If we are in two-dimensional space, this is equation of ellipse. So, but mean-centered ellipse, what does it mean? That the center of the ellipse is in the mean, or the vector of means. Okay, so this is our equation, but we will talk about that more. Let's first compute general sample variance, so that single number. Okay, so say that we have our matrix X given as in previous exercise. So 9, 5, 1, 1, 2, 3, 2. As we need our sample covariance matrix, one of the ways to compute the matrix easier by hand, or if you want to use Excel, even though we showed a little bit easier way to compute it in Excel, but this formula can be handy if you need to compute the sample covariance matrix by hand, if you need to multiply those matrices. So using that one, we can actually get our sample covariance matrix, and we just need to find the determinant. So finding the determinant in a classical way, we just get the number 12. Geometrically, we can say that actually 12 is the area that those two deviation vectors form divided by n minus 1 squared. So 3 minus 1, 2 squared. So we can compute actually area between two deviation vectors using this single value, our generous variance. As usual, we can actually write our deviation vectors in a matrix form. So this is our matrix of deviations, x minus 1, so our mean vector transposed. What we actually get is a matrix where each column is our deviation vector. Another important result is actually that when the determinant, or let's say the determinant of the covariance matrix is zero, if and only if one of the deviation vectors is linear combination of any other two. What does this actually mean? That as we need area that they form, imagine that the two vectors, or say three vectors, lay in the same space. It means that they don't create any volume or any area between them. So if two can be used to represent another one. So linear combination means that if d1 plus d2 is equal to d3, for example, then it means that they lie in the same plane. So there is no area. And obviously the determinant of the sample covariance matrix is zero. So it goes both ways. This is one of interesting results. Let's go to an example where we have matrix X, okay, and we want to compute the matrix of deviations and see if it is full rank. So our matrix of deviations is simply subtracting one x transpose from x. So first note that 1 is a column times, so this is transposed vector, so it is a row. We actually get a matrix 3 times 3. So this is important to notice. It's easy to compute the mean vector, so this is not something that we'll spend time on. And also computation, so you just subtract elements. So we want to know if this matrix has full rank. What actually does it mean? Well, there are many interpretations. So you, for example, you want to know if the vectors, so the columns, are linear independent vectors. So each column is a vector. And you want to check if they're linearly independent. Or if you wish, if it's easier, you can actually check for rows, if rows are linear independent vectors. Okay, however, we can see actually that there exists some non-zero linear combination, okay, that you get actually zero vector. So it actually means that you can represent, for example, d3 using d1 and d2. So it means, because this is d1, d2, and d3, so our columns, it means that they are not linear independent. This automatically means that the matrix is not full rank, because you can get zero here if you wish. Okay, then let's compute the determinant of S, so our general sample variance. Using the same formula as before, you can get this matrix. And actually, the determinant of this matrix is zero. Okay, so this is something that we would expect. Why? Because they are not linearly independent. When they are not linearly independent, it means that one of those is linear combination of another. So if it is linear combination another, that determinant is zero. So this is how we can get, even without computing, the set of covariance matrix. So if you get complicated matrix that you need a lot of time to compute it, so imagine that it's 5 times 5, and you're just asked to compute the generalized variance, you should always check if the deviation vectors are linearly independent. It also is equivalent to check if this matrix is full rank, because those two are all equivalent statements. This is one of the easiest ways to compute it. So it can be, let's say, a trap exercise, where you have complicated sample covariance matrix, but easy to prove that they are linearly independent. Or dependent, because if they are linearly independent, you would still need to compute it, because you don't know what is the general sample variance. This actually geometrically means what I just said, that one lays or in a plane generated by the other two. So what I have mentioned a couple of times, say D1 or D3 can be presented as a sum. And let's compute the total sample variance. What is the total sample variance? It's actually the sum of all our sample variances. So total sample variance is sum of our sample variances. We can see that our sample variances are on our diagonal of the sample covariance matrix. And also we know that trace of this matrix, so trace, we denote it as TR of this matrix, is actually a sum of diagonal elements by the definition. So trace of S is our sample variance. In our case, it's like 9 plus 1 plus 7, so 17. This is our trace. Another interesting result is when you normalize or standardize all observed values that we have, x, j, k, we actually get another matrix, so our, let's say, standardized matrix. And when we compute the sample covariance matrix, okay, of this our new matrix, we actually get our covariance matrix of the original one. So again, say that we transpose our observations, transform or standardize them, and then compute sample covariance matrix, we will get the correlation matrix of the first sample. This is expected, and it can actually be proven and shown. So you can try this for practice. But yeah, this should be obvious. So from original sample, we get S as covariance matrix and R as our correlation matrix. And for our transformed or standardized matrix, we get covariance matrix to be equal to R previously computed. So this is the relation that you can find. This can be used in Excel to compute the correlation matrix a little bit easier. But yeah, let's go to the following problem, in which we have three different sample covariance matrices, say S1, S2, S3. So they're covariance matrices of three different samples. Okay. But we have equal determinants. So we have determinant of each of those to be equal. So the generalized variances are equal. Does the general variance give us some more information? Because they are equal, what would we expect? does it mean that the variation is the same, or what does actually this mean? So let's say that the mean of each, so our mean vector of each of the samples is the same. So say that it is 2, 3. So we are now in two-dimensional space. We have some points, okay, and three cases. In first case, we have our mean vector, okay, and we have some data. Ignore those vectors. But this data, because the for the first sample, we say that the correlation coefficient is 0.9, so it means that when one is increasing, the other one is increasing. So this is basically how the data would look like. So with this arrow. Case 2, where we have, so for the second one, where we have zero correlation coefficient. Again, that doesn't mean that the samples are necessarily independent. It just means that correlation coefficient is zero. So we have that the correlation coefficient is zero. So it, this one. And we have some data. The mean is the same. That's what we said. And case 3, when we have negative. So when one is increasing, the other one is decreasing. So this is how would it look like. So our eigenvalues and eigenvectors of those three matrices, S1, S2, and S3, will determine orientation or the pattern of the data. So using only those eigenvalues and eigenvectors, we can find everything. The orientation and pattern here. As you guessed, those are our eigenvectors. When we have matrices, concrete values, we can always compute the eigenvectors and eigenvalues, and then the orientation will be determined. For example, for the first case, let's say that we have lambda 1 and lambda 2 of our eigenvalues of the first one. They will determine the length of the vector, but the vector itself will determine the orientation. So in this case, if we, for example, have some hyperellipsoid or just ellipse in our case, and we have some constant c squared. Okay, so in direction of the first one, for example, okay, we know that from the mean, okay, this is our mean, we will have in direction of our eigenvector E1 length of our square root of our eigenvalue times the our constant c. Okay, so it is going to be actually this line. Eigenvalue tells us in what direction should we go. Same goes for the other one. So in this direction, from our mean, the direction of E2, and the length would be square root of lambda 2 times c, where c is some constant. This C can actually be chosen depending on how many values, so those dots, you want to take in that ellipse. So you choose C such that this ellipse contains a percentage of your data. But here, what is important is that for now, so we will not mention C yet, because we still don't know distribution of this one, so later. So we can choose C such that this ellipse contains the data that we want. The amount of the data that is of our interest. So in this case, if we choose C, for example, to take 95% of the data, we can construct ellipse with center in our mean me ellipse in those two orientations or outside. And we know that this ellipse will actually contain this data. Same goes here and here. So what we actually found out is that the generalized variance can be the same. In those three cases, it is the same. But we don't know the orientation of the data or the pattern of data just based on the mean and the generalized variance. So eigenvalues and eigenvectors contain a lot of information as well. So in each of those cases, you can compute eigenvalues, eigenvectors, find C that you're interested in based on this one. So when we find out what distribution, imagine that this is a random variable, then we can find C. So hopefully this is clear. So this is just illustration and interpretation of generalized variance. And actually the value of eigenvalues and eigenvectors. So they are really valuable, not just for this. And let's go now to the random sampling. Okay, so we, until now, always denoted X as our matrix of observations. Imagine now that instead of those observations, we have random variables. And instead of our small x's and our small vectors, instead of that we have random vectors. So now each row is a random vector. So what would actually be our sample now? So in univariate, when we said a random sample, we would always mean that we have, for example, n random variables that have same distribution and they're independent. Here, instead of random variables, our random sample is going to be constructed out of random vectors instead. So our random vectors will be independent. Okay, so x1, x2, xn. And they will have some common joint distribution. Okay. And each of those vectors is going to have its own distribution. Okay, let's now look just at one random vector. So this random vector is going to have some probability density function. Okay, so that probability density function is going to be function of more values. So in our case, p values. However, even though this random vector is a vector of, so it is every element is a random variable. Okay, but those random variables in one of the vectors are not independent, not necessarily independent. They may be in some examples, but in general, they have some joint probability density function, okay? And it is not product of marginal. So they are usually correlated. Okay, so for each of those vectors has same probability density function. Because this is the random sample now, what are we talking about? Random sample means that all those vectors among each other are independent observations. Each of those vectors has same probability density function f, and that f is not product of those marginals. However, because they're independent, the joint probability density function of this sample, so this is now a function that is, so represents a joint distribution of random vectors. And in this case, it is a product of marginals But now marginals are the distribution of vectors. So this is why we can actually write the joint probability density as a product of those. Okay, so this is probability density of first one, this is probability density function of second, but they are the same, just of different values. So this is what you should be careful. Okay, so just to mention that those, again, those random variables are usually correlated. Those vectors are independent. So the measurements between trials and the joint probability, because they are independent, is the product of marginals. Okay, so let's see how can we actually compute mean of our x bar and covariance of x bar. We know how it's defined, so x bar is 1 over n times the sum of our vectors. So now our vectors are x1, x2, xn. This is why we write them as large, so we know that they are random variables. So expected value of x, expected value goes true. So sum, expected value of a sum is sum of expected values, and the constant goes in front. This is property that still stays, because distribution of all vectors is the same. It means that they have the same mean, because probability density function is the same. So you can always compute mean and it will be the same. Because we have n, it's going to be mu times, n times, so we actually get mu. It means that our, now we can say statistic, is unbiased estimator of our parameter mi, of our mean. So because we said that we will avoid multivariate calculus as much as we can, however, just to mention that expected values can always be computed using these functions. So as integrals. In a case you might, if for example you have bivariate distribution, you can use double integral or similar. But this is just so you know. And let's compute covariance matrix of our x to see what actually happens. And when we compute covariance, we will actually know the approximate distribution, how does the mean and covariance look like of x. So by the definition is expected value of this. This is the definition. So then we substitute what is x. X is 1 over n, sum of our xi's. Okay. And our mu can be written, so we can see that mu can actually be written like this. Right, so 1 divided by n times n is 1. And we just substitute it. Then we have that 1 over n can go in front. And when we have summation, it is going to be the same as this one. So we'll have n times mu. So we can just write mu here, because n times mu will be included in this sign. Similar here. Okay, so this is important for later, so we need to prove it step by step. Then, so we have expected value of some multiplications. So imagine that when we multiply each term here with n terms here, so we will get n terms. And because we have n terms here, because sum goes through n, we will have n times n sums when we multiply each with each one. Okay, so we can actually, the sum can go in front because we multiply it, and the property of expected value. And then we get this one, this part. So how do we get to this one? So we lost the whole sum. Well, what we mentioned is that the sample is independent. So we had a random sample here. X1, X2 through Xn are independent random vectors. It means that because they are independent, that their covariance is zero. Okay, so this is zero and this is zero for I different than j. Okay, so this is why, because in the sum, always when we multiply different ones, okay, so different covariances, we get zero. So we lose one, and actually we get only with the equal ones. So here, instead of j, we actually have y. So I. And it is actually covariance, okay, and it is a random sample with the same covariance and the same mean. Okay, this is our assumption, as well as here is our assumption that the mean is the same. And the covariance is the same. So n times here, and we get 1 divided by n sigma. Obviously, what would we expect? It's different than sigma. And we can find the relation between our univariate case and the distribution of our x when we had only univariate random variables. So it is still the mean and 1 divided by n, but our variance. So we had sigma squared there. Okay. So what naturally would come up to mind is our SN unbiased estimator. So far, I tried to avoid using n minus 1 in our SN, but instead we always used n. However, after this proof, we will usually use S, and we will think of that as unbiased estimator. So you can see where this leads. You already know that this is not unbiased estimator, but let's see why and how to prove it. So, by the definition of Sn, we know that it's defined like this. Okay, so the constant can go in front. And we can multiply each, so this one with the first one, and the same, this one with the second one. Okay, this is just simple multiplication. Then we can actually separate this to see how does it look like. So this one, it's simple to prove that it is actually zero. So this one is not dependent on n of I, so you can go in front, okay? But what actually would happen? So I mean, it does not influence anything here. It should not go in front because this is matrix, so it just does not depend on y. So what actually we have here, it's sum of xi minus n times x, okay? And this is actually equal to, this x is actually equal to our sample average. And as you can see, those two are equal, so it is our zero vector. Zero vector times our vector, so again, it does not go in front, it just does not depend. Y is zero. So we can remove this term, cancel. It's zero. The other term, when we multiply each of those, so this with this and this with this, we will get those two parts. What can we do with this one? Just take the sum, so sum of xy's transposed. So it is n times our x, but transposed, because our sum is transposed, okay? So it is going to be our vector transposed. And in the end, we need to use a property that we will later prove to get this result. So if this is our v and v transposed, so our xi and xi transposed, we can actually use covariance of V, so this is covariance of those two, and our covariance is only sigma, plus its mean, so the mean is mu, this is what we proved earlier, Same goes here, but what we know now is that the expected value of x bar is mu, so it is unbiased. But what is our covariance? Because here in the sum we need covariance of x bar. And our covariance of x bar is 1 over n times sigma. So we get this expression. We will prove this equality later. So our last problem will be actually proof of this one. What we get is actually, so this is now just simple algebra. We get those two are same, so it is zero. And we can take sigma, because it's the same, and we have 1, so 1 minus 1 over n. Okay, so it is 1 minus 1 n sigma. So it is obviously different than sigma. So this is different than sigma. So it is biased. However, when we multiply this expression with n over n minus 1, okay, we will actually get sigma. So n over n minus 1 times this expression will be unbiased. Okay, so actually here, instead of sigma, it should be Sn. So let's go back here. What is our Sn? So it is 1 over n, our sum. Okay, so say that we multiply it with this, we will actually get, again, n. So instead of 1 over n, we would have n divided by n minus 1 times 1 over n. So just 1 divided by n minus 1, and it would cancel here. So we actually get that this is unbiased statistic for our covariance matrix. So now we can use this as our estimator. And always from now we'll have S as divided by n minus 1. Okay, and last problem for this lecture, to prove the equality that we previously mentioned. So assume that we have some random vector with mean mu v and this covariance matrix. So we can see that this is not the sample covariance matrix, so it is covariance matrix, just for the notation. So let's see what is our expectation of v transpose. This is what we used. But instead, we will find covariance, and from covariance, because it's easier, we can find this expression. So by the definition, the covariance is this, so we just multiply each with each, okay, so v with v, and mean of v. But because this is transposed, we have both of those transposed. So transposed, okay, and transposed. So we should be careful. So what we have? Expected value of, let's say, sum. It is sum of expected values, right? But what we know that this is constant. This is constant and this is constant. And the expected value of constant is constant, or constant goes in front of expected value. Also, expected value of v, for example, is mean. So what we actually get is just the mean. And expected value of transposed vector is mean transposed, so mean transposed. So we get that one. Two of those cancel, and we just get E, expected value of V retransposed, minus our means. When we just move it to the right side, okay, we get this expression that we used earlier. So this is it for today's class. If something is not clear, you can always contact me or comment below. Thank you for your attention and see ya next time. Bye.